Tonight's top EU stories from the unit website include George Osborne, Britain should create its own European free trade zone. EU curb on food speculation gets qualified welcome from activists. And Scottish independence, European Union financial benefits outlined. Britain thwarts EU plan to create binding fracking rules. Plus, the British Constitution and a judicial eureka moment. I'm Rick Timmis, and this is the Unit Nightly News. First, from our homepage. Britain should try to form a free trade zone within the European Union to speed up completion of the single market, George Osborne has said. The Chancellor said that like-minded countries should be able to create a free trade agreement in the same way as 11 member states, including Germany and France, have signed up for the financial transaction tax. Speaking at the Open Europe Conference on EU reform, Mr. Osborne expressed frustration that, despite numerous leaders' meetings to discuss advancing the single market, precious little has ever come of them. He also warned that the UK was ready to leave the EU if it did not reform. We need to stop talking about completing the single market in services, energy and digital and get on with it, he said. He added, we need to come up with innovative ideas to overcome the vested interests that are holding back progress in this area. Oh, this is interesting. Old Georgie Porgy appears to be speaking with a forked tongue. On the one hand, he talks, give us reform or else we'll leave, and on the other, he wants progression on the single market. This is much the same slimy deception that David Cameron appears to be playing. Talk of EU reform, repatriation of powers in the UK media, and yet embracing the EU and actively encouraging its expansion. Take a look at this video of Big Cheese Dave Cameroni talking at Davos just last week.
And I remain a strong supporter of widening the membership of the European Union, which has been a long-standing British aim. I think it's been a very successful policy.
So, my friends, as you can see, some of the folks at the top aren't playing with a straight bat. Development activists have given a guarded welcome to moves by the European Union to curb food speculation by limiting the use of financial instruments linked to commodities, which has been blamed for the rise in food prices. The controls will place a limit on the number of contracts on agricultural commodities such as wheat, corn, soybean and sugar that banks and other finance companies can hold, and will force traders to open their activities to greater public scrutiny. The European Commission, the EU's executive arm, said the rules on agricultural derivatives would contribute to orderly pricing and prevent market abuse, thus curbing speculation on commodities and the disastrous impacts it can have on the world's poorest populations. The rules are seeking to ban unregulated trading and establish tighter rules for high-frequency trading, which some blame for increasing volatility. High-frequency trading, which involves computers making split-second decisions based on mathematical models, has become increasingly widespread in financial markets. There must be some point at which the world changed. Surely we haven't been financialized like this since the dawn of time. Well, it turns out that that is actually a good question to ask, and indeed, financial deregulation and the financialization does indeed have a start date. Interestingly, that date is 1971, when the United States of America came away from the gold standard, and the European Union was fledging its wings. Interestingly, the UK joined the EU in 1971, and of course the idea of unsupported or fiat money was just getting started. By the mid to late 1970s, the privatisation, or perhaps I should say the corporatisation of public assets, had begun, and by the mid-1980s it was in full flow, and as we saw at the time, the City of London was awash with money. Sadly, it appears that not one of those Lamborghini-driving yuppies had the foresight to ask where the cash flow was coming from. The short answer, of course, is from the balance sheet of the nation, as the government continued to sell off its assets. The result? Well, take a look at this clip from the Kaiser Report.
Well, Mao would do very well up there at the Davos Forum. And, you know, it was created in 1971, and it was called then European Management Forum. when it first started. And it didn't rename itself until 1987 when it called itself the World Economic Forum. But, you know, the 80s were, of course, the time at the beginning of this whole financialization of the world, and it became more of a banker's hangout and bankers hanging out with politicians. So I want to look at the world that they've created because, you know, a lot of people say they're up there to save the world. This is why these bankers meet, to give their elite opinion about how we should save the world. But if you look at this chart from Charles Hugh Smith, it's a percent change in real income since 1948. Now, the top 10% is that red line, and the bottom 90% is the blue line. And as you can see, it rose sharply for the top 10% around 1982, and it just tore away from the blue line, the bottom 90%, where they were rising all together for the first 50 years of that chart.
Yeah, that's right. Since 1971, you say?
Yep.
You know, that's, of course, when the U.S. went off the gold standard. Mm-hmm. And we began a period of financialization and global financialization and global derivatives that were based on global financialization, which has been the engineering trick to create this massive wealth inequality. And it's continued now thanks to meetings like Davos or Bilderberg or any of these other global confabs where bankers, industrialists, and crooks get together to figure out new ways to impoverish the globe. And they're doing an outstanding job.
Scotland would benefit from hundreds of millions of pounds extra funding with thousands more jobs created if it was an independent member of the European Union, Nicola Sturgeon claimed in a keynote speech last night. The deputy SNP leader used a speech in Edinburgh to claim that if Scotland was represented as an independent nation in the EU, it would have received £850 million in common agriculture policy funding, which she said would have supported an extra 2,500 jobs. Ms. Sturgeon said the CAP funding would increase economic output by £1 billion from 2014 to 2020, and she went on to claim that Scotland had been short-changed by decisions at Westminster, which she said had left Scots with the lowest farm payments in the EU. Sounds like a good deal, right? Well, let's do some maths. £1 billion is £1,000 million. Take away £850 million in Euro kleptocrat gift aid, and you're left with £150 million, which, amortised over the 6 years between 2014 and 2020, is £25 million per year. So, what Ms. Sturgeon is actually saying is that in return for selling out the sovereignty of the Scottish people, she and her SNP party will generate a return of 3% from the EU's cash injection. Well, that strikes me as a pretty poor return. But what do some of the Scottish people think about the SNP? Well, from our Google Plus page, Scottish countryman Vedic Pagan 01 wrote, "I hate the Socialist Knobheads Party. I want them all to disappear. Oh yeah, and I'm Scottish, folks, and I hate living in a commie-style one-party nation. I don't want to be a socialist state in a Marxist totalitarian Euro ever, ever, ever. It makes the UK look sweet in comparison, so I'm happy here. Vote no to fake Scottish independence." Well, I've said it before, independence can't be achieved by subserving to a foreign power. You'd think that that was pretty obvious, wouldn't you, really? A determined lobbying campaign led by Britain has buried plans for the European Union to legislate uniform regulations on shale gas exploration across the 28 member states. Instead, the European Commission, the European Union's executive branch, will issue a non-binding recommendation next week asking governments to submit their plans for shale exploration and extraction and to outline their proposals for public review, EU officials have said. The document, to be released on Jan 22nd, is a significant setback for opponents of hydraulic fracturing, who sought hard and fast rules to protect the public from threats they feared the drilling process will bring. The Commission originally planned to issue a directive which would require legislative approval by the European Parliament and would have the force of law. Now, fracking is a far more volatile issue in Europe than in the United States. France and Romania have banned it outright, while Germany has adopted a moratorium. Except for the United Kingdom and Poland, few other EU nations have shown much interest in shale. And today in our video library, we'll be looking further into this topic. Now, Roger Wright Morris, LLB, wrote into us with a brilliant and detailed letter in regard to our current predicament. Here are some excerpts. It seems that the UK judiciary, at least one or two, are belatedly reawakening to the loss of sovereignty and also the loss in the UK of the democratic process. Westminster parliamentarians in this age of the United States of Europe seem to have abandoned any will to do other than acknowledge that there is nothing that Parliament can do to avoid unwanted directives derived and implemented by the great unknown, unelected and unaccountable bureaucrats in Brussels. Well, theoretically, they are correct. However, the government of Edward Heath was a traitor to this very kingdom and its institutions. Until we acceded to the European community, there was nothing in our law that future governments were bound by in perpetuity. They are now, in theory and in practice, until the will is found and exercised to do something about it. The UK is in the middle of a dangerous quandary. There is the stew of disenchantment with nearly all aspects of current politics and politicians, disenchantment of the existing state of the House of Commons, the Liberal Party's determination to bring about elections to the House of Lords, the awakening of the UK judiciary at last to the loss of UK democracy and sovereignty, the West Lothian issue, the Scotland referendum issues, the financial burdens upon the UK of Brussels, red tape and the payment each hour of more than £1 million, and that's net of rebates by the UK to Brussels, the UK guarantees for the doomed euro, and much, much more besides. Well, it is little wonder, therefore, that there is open discussion by David Starkey of his feeling that in the UK there is the increasing smell of revolution in the air. We need to deal with these issues energetically, promptly, honestly and openly, and we need parliamentarians with a will to do so. Now, you'll find the full letter in the Your Letters category of our blog section. So, today in our video library, well, what the frack is going on? As UK politicians ramp up the lobby for fracking on a massive scale in the UK, the Truth Seeker programme investigates some of the issues surrounding this controversial process. And let's make it clear, the UK is going hell for leather to get its gas fracking programme rolled out across Britain. And furthermore, here at the unit, we have discovered that French company Total is one of the leading companies involved in fracking the gas out of the UK landscape. And interesting development when one considers that fracking is totally banned in France. However, let's just take a view from a distance. The UK recovery appears to be an illusion, just a simple function of the government's policy to reinflate the housing bubble. UK balance of payments is way out of kilter. In a nutshell, Great Britain is bust, broke, going bankrupt. Now, Big Cheese DC and his sidekicks Cleggy and George, having liquidated the balance sheet, well, now they're on a mission to sell out our untapped primary resources with a high risk of poisoning the environment and our water for generations to come. Now, I can't put this any more plainly. If you want a positive and healthy future for your children and your children's children, then it's time to get up, stand up and take some action. Email Andrew from our website and we'll help you get started. I'm Rick Timmis, reporting for the Unit Nightly News. I'll see you soon.